Hey y'all, in this video I'm going to get a little bit deeper into the Distort Selected Objects tool. Now if you missed my previous video on Distort Selected Objects, I'll put a link up here in a card right about now, and I'll also put a link down in the description box to this video. Also, keep in mind, at the end of every video in this Absolute Beginner series, I place a card on the end screen. That is a link to the playlist of all of the videos here in the Absolute Beginner series. So if you'd like to start with part one and work your way up from there, that's the place to go, is to that playlist. Also, there's a link down in the description to this playlist. Even though I'm using Aspire version 10.019 for this demonstration, everything I'm getting ready to show you works identically in VCarve Desktop and VCarve Pro. To distort a vector object, we need to have a vector object out here. So I'm going to go ahead and draw an ellipse out here. I want to anchor the center of that ellipse on my x0, y0. And I'll just go ahead and accept whatever measurements are in here because it doesn't really matter for this demonstration. I'll click Create and close it. From here, I'll go ahead and select the vector and jump over into the Distort Selected Objects tool. Now, in the previous video, I focused on distorting the vector above a single curve and between two curves, but I did not get into using the bounding box at all. And that's going to be the main focus of this video. So, as you see, the bounding box is selected as the default when you go into the Distort Objects tool form. And we have here a notice that says the selected vectors are valid. My Apply button is highlighted, but everything down here in Edit Envelope is grayed out. That's because we can't edit an envelope until we've created one. So I'm going to use the bounding box. I'll click Apply. And now that's opened up Edit the Envelope. The envelope is, in this case, this bounding box out here. We have a start point down in the bottom corner here, and then these three points here that help to describe this bounding box. Also notice this is a start point, and we have a little arrow to the right of it. And this arrow is pointing in this direction. That's letting us know that this box was drawn starting here to this point, then up to this point, up to this point, then back down to the start point. While that's not really relevant to us in this particular situation, that may be relevant to you in another case where you have a very busy pattern out here with a lot of different vectors or vectors inside of vectors, etc., etc. Also notice that my cursor has changed to the arrowhead just as if I were in node editing mode. Now, I'm not actually in node editing mode. I'm in kind of a transitional state here, in that I can edit to a certain point, but it's not exactly the same as node editing. It does use some of the same node editing tools, however. To use this bounding box, which is what this blue line, this dotted blue line around here is, I have several options. If you notice, when I bring my cursor down here over, for instance, this top line here, a little tilde suddenly appears. I move away from it, it disappears. The same thing happens if I get over here to the side. That's letting me know that I'm over one of the spans of the bounding box that I can modify. If I get over a point, my cursor changes to that square with the crosshairs over it. That's letting me know I'm over a position along this span that I can also make modifications to. It's very difficult to see, but if you look up right up here in the center, you'll see a transparent box. That's indicating the midpoint of this span of my bounding box. If I put my cursor over that, you'll see it also changes to a square with the crosshairs on it. All four of these points can be manipulated individually. If I want to grab hold of a point, click and drag it down, you can see that I've moved this point at about a 45 degree angle, a distance of 1.5 inches. I let go, we see that it's modified my oval. I'm going to hold down Control and tap the letter Z to undo that change. I can do the same thing with any of these points, moving them in any direction I choose. To modify this vector shape inside the bounding box. Now I'm going to again hold down Control and tap the letter Z to undo all of those changes. But you begin to see some of the things we can do with this bounding box. If we want to give it a change the perspective of this vector a little bit, we can bring both of these in. On this side, we'll go in 2 inches, and we'll go in 2 inches on this one as well. We can see that we've almost got a perfect egg here, which may come in handy during Easter time. Let me hold down Control, tap the letter Z again to undo those changes. Now, we can not only change and move these points here, we can move entire spans. I can bring this span down by clicking and dragging, and you see my index line that suddenly appeared, showing me that I'm pulling it straight down. And that's changed the height of this vector here by manipulating the size of the bounding box. I can also make it slightly longer by adjusting my bounding box out here and just modifying the size as well as the aspect ratio of the vector. Let me Control Z to undo all of those changes. Now I'm not limited to these four points out here. As I mentioned, the center of these spans here, if I put my cursor over that center, that can be made into a point that I can manipulate as well. I just click it, and we see that has now become a red point. Now the red just simply means that's active. If I come out here and click this one, that becomes active. But if I come and click on this point right here, I can drag that point up. Let's move it up to 1 inch and release. Click off, and we now have a new point added up here. I can also come over here, click, drag that one in an inch, click, drag this one in an inch, and again, we're distorting our shape. Now you notice I keep clicking off and then selecting the vector again to take me back into edit the envelope, which is what we're doing. We're editing this envelope, this bounding box. Let me Control Z to undo all of those changes. I'm also not limited to adding a point to the center of this span. Anywhere I want to go, out here along this way, for instance, I can make sure I have that little tilde under my cursor, right click, and I can insert a point. Then I can maneuver and manipulate that point as well. Control Z to undo those changes. Some of you may have noticed that when I bring my cursor up here onto the span, I can right-click. I can also change that straight line to a Bezier or an arc. So let's go ahead and change it to a Bezier curve. And that makes this top span of the bounding box, gives us these two control handles that I can now bend down. Let's drag it down here. Then we'll come along and we'll pull this one up. Kind of curve it up this way to kind of give it a funky shape out here. Bring that one out to the center. And we have a jelly bean or a coffee bean or whichever. Select the vector again. This shows you that you can create some pretty off-the-wall shapes and get into quite a bit of distortion depending upon what you need to do with the vector that you're working with. Down here, we notice that we're in edit envelope mode. The envelope in this case is this bounding box. If it were between two curves or above a single curve, that envelope would be the contours of that single curve or those two curves. If we move up here to transform object, we basically just go into the same move and transform mode that we would have outside of the distort object, and we go into move and transform mode. It's basically the same thing. Yes, I can grab hold of one of these squares out here and resize, but if you notice, it kept the same aspect ratio. When I brought it down in this direction, it reduced the height as well as the width. Let me control Z to undo that. Editing the envelope means you're editing that box that the vector sits in, and that's going to apply that distortion only to the area that you select. The rest of the aspect ratio stays the same. Control Z to undo that modification. And I'm going to bring this back up here because my jelly bean lost some of its shape. That brings me down here to this button at the bottom, which is Bake Distortion. Without baking this distortion, what we have is a vector that's kind of in a transitional phase. It is a vector, but it's not a completed vector. It hasn't been finalized. It's a distorted vector that can be used for a lot of things, but it can't really be edited yet. I'll show you what I mean. If I just go ahead and close this, select the vector, and tap the letter N on my keyboard to go into node editing, the bounding box opens up again. The vector has not been completely converted to curves, so I can go into node editing and cut the vector or change from a Bezier curve to an arc or something of that nature. It's being treated right now as a transitional object and not an editable vector object. So, the way to fix that, select it, go back into Distort, make sure I'm back in Edit Envelope, not Move and Transform. And once I'm certain I have the shape exactly the way I want it, this is the way I want this vector, that's the final shape I'm after, I'll come down here and bake that distortion. What that effectively does is converted this vector to curves. So now, if I close my distortion window with the vector still selected, tap the letter N on my keyboard, and I can go into standard node edit mode, make subtle changes here and there to change the shape just like any other vector. So now that I have converted that vector to curves, if I select it and go back into move and transform mode, I can't get back into my bounding box. Because now that it's been converted to curves and that distortion we made earlier has been baked, this is just like any other vector. Nothing that we did up here really applies to it anymore. If I need to come in and edit this for some reason, and I want to use the distortion tool, I have to select my bounding box, apply it again, then I can come back up, change this to a Bezier, for example, and move this around slightly to get more of the jelly bean shape that I'm after. Bake that distortion, close, and I have a vector I can now edit in node editing or go ahead and use to VCarve, cut out a profile, or what have you. The important takeaway from this is when you are finished distorting your object, you're done editing your envelope or your bounding box or even your single curve or between two curves, bake that distortion so you can use all of your editing tools. So, I hope you got something out of this video. If you did, I would appreciate a thumbs up. Now, don't forget, today at 12 p.m. noon Pacific Time, 3 p.m. Eastern Time, right here on my YouTube channel, I'll be hosting a live Q&A session where we'll discuss anything I've covered in this video or the previous video on using the Distort Selected Objects tool. Again, that's today at 3 p.m. Eastern Time, noon Pacific Time, right here on my YouTube channel. And I'll put a link to that live Q&A down in the description of this video here. These live Q&A sessions are a great excuse to subscribe to my channel. And when you hit that red subscribe button down below, click that little notification bell right next to it. Then you'll get a notification the next time I post a video or the next time I go live. So, I hope to see you this afternoon for that live Q&A session. And as always, whether you subscribe to my channel or not, I'd like to thank you very much for taking the time to watch, and y'all take care.